Chapter 25, 1948, Breaking Barriers. Jackie Robinson is given a great deal of credit for integrating Major League Baseball, and rightly so. But there were many other players who also played important roles in integrating baseball and breaking barriers which were sometimes as old and stubborn as those put up by the big leagues. There were many players who knew what it was like to be the only black player on a team or in a league. Double Duty was one of those players. In 1948, Double Duty integrated two leagues. The first was the longest-running semi-pro league in the history of baseball. The second was perhaps the strongest semi-pro loop in the country at the time. The Southern Minnesota League, Southern Mini for short, was organized around the turn of the century and continued into the 1960s. The league featured several future major leaguers over the years, the most prominent being Sam Toothpick Jones, who threw a no-hitter for the Rochester Aces in 1949, a few years before making it big with the Chicago Cubs, and Moose Gowron, who played in 1950 with the Austin Packers, before going on to a famed career with the New York Yankees. Controversy was nothing new to Rochester, Minnesota baseball. The Southern Minis Rochester Aces made waves in the 1920s when they signed Major League cast-off Swede Risberg of 1919 Chicago White Sox infamy. And in 1947, the Southeastern Minnesota League's Rochester Queens signed Greed Lefty McInnes, a veteran of the Negro Leagues. McInnes probably became the first black player to ever play in a semi-pro league in Minnesota. It was a small but important step. In this interview, Bob Petersdorf, a Rochester baseball official in 1947 and 48, recalls the controversy when Rochester started signing black players.
We caused an awful stir when he brought in McInnes back in those days. And I don't know if it ever says that, but Ben could tell you more about it. And Lefty, he came in Ben's office there one day, and he said, "Boy, I got a heck of an outfielder for you." And he was 16 at that time, or 15. And we decided, geez, that's a little too young. And it was Willie Mays. Yeah, we made a mistake. Next year, or 2 years, with the Millers, you know. Yeah, that's as close as even old Lefty was a. He was really from Oldenville. He's a great ball player.
Yeah,
he was right.
In April of 1948, Double Duty was signed by the Rochester Aces and became the first black player in the Southern Mini League's half-century history. A few weeks later, the crosstown rival Rochester Queens, now in the new Bi-State League, signed Lefty McInnes. Both players were signed as featured hurlers, meaning they were expected to pitch virtually every game.
The Southern Mini League had teams in Rochester, Winona, Mankato, Albert Lea, Austin, Owatonna, Faribault, and Waseca. How did I get up there? There's a man in Rochester who's a friend of Abe Saperstein's named Bill Bernstein. He is crazy for me because I played a couple of tournaments for him years back. He asked me to play, so I went up there. It wasn't too bad, but those times they call you all kinds of names. Nigger and everything else. They paid me $800 a month. But back in those days, that's good money for blacks. We weren't playing but 3 games a week, and they paid me extra to help the kids on the American Legion team. Lefty McInnes, another black pitcher, was up there, and he made extra money shining shoes downtown in Rochester. He's a lot younger than me, though. I was 46 years old. I didn't want none of that shoe-shining crap.
The 1948 Rochester Aces were pinning all of their hopes for success on the arm and bat of Double Duty. Quote, "Double Duty Radcliffe is considered as one of the league's best pitchers," reported the Rochester Tribune, "and the Negro Slinger is a bad man with the wood and may wind up as one of the league's top hitters." Unquote. As it turned out, the Aces were a disaster, probably the worst team Double Duty had played for since his ragball days in Mobile. To say that Double Duty didn't receive support when he pitched would not begin to tell the story. The infield was by far the worst in the league, with each infielder turning routine plays into gray hairs on Double Duty's head, and the hitting was non-existent. After a man pitches with the likes of Willie Wells, Bobby Robinson, and Joe Desiderato behind him, it's hard to deal with Larry Moe and Curly. In a game against Owatonna, Double Duty gave up 10 runs, all unearned, thanks to 6 Rochester errors, and in the following game, Double Duty again didn't allow an earned run and lost 4-0, the second baseman and shortstop combining for 5 errors. Bad defense, racial slurs, and being the only black player in the league wore on double duty, and he was gone in late May with 1 win, 5 losses, and a 2.54 ERA.
I pitched one game up there in Owatonna, and I gave up 4 hits and they got 6 runs. The shortstop made 4 errors himself. The umpire said, "You making a fool out of these young kids. They can't hit you." They couldn't hit me, and adults and kids were yelling at me, calling me a nigger, black monkey, kin to a bear. So I never will forget. We went to Albert Lea. They had the best team, and we beat them bad, 13-1. When I got back after the game, my wife had packed all the stuff in my car. I had a 46 DeSoto made by Chrysler. She said, "Come on, let's go. You ain't gonna let these people humiliate you. You up here giving them recreation and they treat you like that?" So we pulled out. I had to consider my wife's feelings. In all my years in baseball, that was the worst treatment I ever got. You know it was bad. So when I got home, my mother said I had a message to call South Bend, Indiana, and a message to call Mexico. My mother was living with us then at 33rd and Cottage Grove in Chicago. So I called a guy, left the gun in South Bend. He had a team in a league in Indiana. It was a hell of a semi-pro league, and he asked me to get some players. I brought Howard Easterling and Lefty McInnes, and we went down there and turned things around. Our team was backed by the Studebaker plant. See, back then, there were great semi-pro teams all over the country. These big factories could get players to play ball and give them jobs in the factory. It was hard to do both, but it paid better than the Negro leagues, even the big leagues sometimes. I got $750 a month to play and $450 to stand up on a broom at the auto plant there. Easterling and them were working in the plant, but I didn't want to fall asleep and get chewed up by a machine, so I said, "Give me a broom." After 2 months, they put me in a department where they made fenders. The head of the union was my boss, and I'd come in the morning and clean out his office, and he'd make the coffee. At 9 o'clock every day, he'd say, "Double duty, go on home and hit a home run tonight. I'll punch you out." I had it made, and I stayed and worked that winter. I was dumb, though. If I'd stayed a few years, I'd have a good pension, and I'd be sitting pretty. I couldn't stand the noise in the plant, though, and I never could work because I had a bad heart.
The Michigan-Indiana League was 6 years old when Double Duty signed with the South Bend Studebaker factory team in early June and became the first black in league's history. Speedy outfielder Sam Hill, slugging infielder Howard Easterling, and pitcher Lefty McInnes soon followed. The MI League, as it was called, was considered to be AAA minor league caliber because of its many ex-major and minor leaguers. It was made up of the Lafayette Red Sox, Fort Wayne GE Voltmen, St. Joseph Oscos, Michigan City Cubs, Benton Harbor Buds, Kalamazoo Peter Pans, Kenosha Red Sox, and the South Bend Studebaker Athletics. The following are clips of interviews with two of Double Duty's teammates on the South Bend Studebakers. First outfielder Tommy DeMarc, then infielder Dick Hosinski.
We had one of the best summer pro clubs here in the country. We played with Hoosier Bears, and then we joined that AAA. We played with South Bend Studebaker's factory. Well, I worked on the inspection line. First I worked in the block line, and I was on the inspection line.
Did you ever own a Studebaker?
Oh, yeah, did I ever own one. I had a champion, had 100-some thousand miles, and still looked like new.
What was Duty like when you played with him?
Oh, he's a comedian, but he was a good ball player. Heck, all these fingers are...
Man.
So he had a good arm, and he did everything good but run. But he had power. He's a well-built guy. He's one of these solid guys. But he's a comedian, I'll tell you that. Well, he'd had you laughing all the time, really. Like I told you, he was a character. He was funny. He was talking all the time, but he was a good hitter. I can remember Easterling. We had a guy by the name of McInnes. Oh, hell, he could have pitched for any big leagues. But he'd pitch for us, and then I didn't know that he'd catch a plane, go up Minnesota, and pitch for somebody up there under a different name. I didn't know.
Oh, really?
Yeah, well, that's what he would do, and I didn't know until I found out later. But he could have pitched with anybody. We couldn't play too much down here because we wasn't drawn good, and we had to, that's why we dropped out of the league. Yeah.
But, like, the fan support in South Bend, they were pretty supportive? And
yeah, well, if you played a color team, they were really supportive. But, because we had a good ball club. As a matter of fact, there's no comparison between the Ray ball club and our ball club. We'd eat them up. But they draw. They got a beautiful park here now and everything. And but we couldn't draw unless we played exhibition against the Negro ball clubs. They wouldn't serve us meals with the Negroes. We couldn't go to restaurants.
Really? No. In 40, even in like 48?
Yeah, that was about, well, no, let's, yeah, in the 40s, yeah. Right. They would have to carry out stuff, and that's it. And when the ordinary wouldn't serve our color bumpers, we walked a lot of there.
Double duty Radcliffe, yeah. Can't he do anything? Oh, he was sensational. He was a hell of a guy. Yeah. He was good to the younger players. He was very good. He was a good hitter and a hell of a catcher. Oh, he was great. You know, when we played, when we had to go to Grand Rapids or something, they had to eat in the kitchen. Yeah. Wouldn't allow them in the dining room, you know.
What was your salary at Studebaker's?
Oh, boy. 2.5 a ball game.
Really?
Yeah. Warren Bartz, Bartz. He was the athletic director of Studebaker's, and he managed the ball club, but he didn't know nothing. He owes me $2.5.
$2.5.
Yeah. And but, then I went to the pro ball. I went to Grand Rapids later on. And, oh, boy. It was in the Central League, but they went bankrupt in 34. Yeah, then. And it signed me. We had Claude Pesso with the old Cubs. Yeah. Then they signed him after the league broke up. They signed him and three other ball players to Charleston, West Virginia in the Mid-Atlantic League. And I played a couple of years, and then I went for a tryout camp in Grand Rapids for Detroit, and I made it. I got $90 a month, boy. I had a good time. I had a good education out of it.
The Studebakers had lost their first 8 games of the season when Double Duty joined the team, and quickly the team became 0-9. Against Lafayette, featuring old friend Joe Desiderato at third base, Double Duty took off the pads after catching the first 7 innings and went to the mound to rescue the starting pitcher who had loaded the bases. Instead of saving the day as he had done a few hundred times before, he gave up a triple to the first batter, followed by a Desiderato sack fly, and the Studebakers sunk deeper into last place. The Studebakers added the Chicago Bears' all-time leading punter, George Julianix, to help with catching duties, but he was used sparingly, as Double Duty soon emerged as the top hitter on the team, maybe in the entire league. Double Duty was especially deadly against Negro League teams, and for good reason. After playing for more than 35 teams in the previous 30 years, there were few Negro League pitchers Double Duty would face in 1948 that he hadn't batted against before or caught for before. With his near photographic memory, Double Duty literally knew what each pitcher would throw in each situation. Here are recaps from some of the year's most exciting games. June 18th, the Cincinnati Crescents came to town with Negro League stars Lyman Bostock, George Jefferson, Howard Easterling, and future major leaguer Bill Bruton. Double Duty doubled and singled to lead the offense in a 4-2 win, and after the game, Duty convinced Easterling to join the Studebakers. June 21st, Double Duty started one of the most impressive hitting binges of his career as the Studebakers swept a doubleheader from Kalamazoo. Duty went 2-for-4 in the opener and singled as a pinch hitter in the nightcap. July 2nd, against the Cleveland Buckeyes, Radcliffe drove in 6 runs on a grand slam and 2-run blast. Both homers came off Sam Jethro, who had become the National League Rookie of the Year in 1950 as an outfielder with the Boston Braves. July 3rd, Double Duty singled twice and drove in the winning run against Lester Lockett and his Chicago Monarchs. July 5th, Double Duty homered and singled in a loss to the Toledo Cubs. July 6th, before the biggest crowd of the year, 3,000, Double Duty singled twice and blasted a 2-run double off the top of the center field fence against Lafayette. July 7th, after celebrating his 46th birthday, Double Duty hit safely against the Fort Wayne GE Voltmen, winners of the Wichita Semi-Pro Tournament from 47 through 50. July 8th, double duty singled against the New Orleans Creole, who featured female outfielders Fabiola Wilson and Gloria Diamond, probably the first women to ever play in the Negro Leagues. Wilson and Diamond were primarily on New Orleans for publicity, but a few years later, the Creole signed a female player who could actually compete in the Negro Leagues, Marcenia Tony Stone. Had Stone been allowed to perform in the All-American Girls Baseball League, which was segregated, she likely would have been a superstar. Instead, she continued playing with men on the Indianapolis Clowns and Kansas City Monarchs before retiring in the mid-1950s. July 15th. Double duty finally went hitless as a pinch hitter against the Benton Harbor Buds, ending his 9-game hitting streak in which he went 16 for 30 with 3 home runs and a double for a .553 average and an .867 slugging percentage. Double duty homered in his next game against Benton Harbor before hurting his finger, which kept him out of the league all-star game. July 24th. It was a lot like a class reunion for double duty as the Memphis Red Sox came to town with old friends Neil Robinson, Bubba Hyde, Joe Scott, and the father-son team of Willie Wells and his son Willie Jr. Radcliffe and Howard Easterling each drove in 2 runs in a Studebaker rout, 12-2. The Zulu Cannibal Giants, donning grass skirts, earrings, nose rings, and body paint, came to South Bend. The New York Age once wrote of the Zulus, quote, "They wear traditional African clothing, which is attractive and allows freedom of movement. The reason they are so successful is they have less encumbrances from clothing than their opponents," unquote. Well, the Zulus may have had freedom of movement, but they had little baseball ability, and the Studebakers beat them 20-2, with double duty singling once and tripling, yes, tripling, twice. July 30th. Further proof of the Michigan-Indiana League's AAA rating. Lafayette beat the Washington Senators 7-5. August 4th. Double duty homered in the 9th inning to beat the Harlem Globetrotters and appeared to be starting another hot streak. August 5th. In the 3rd inning against Benton Harbor, double duty ran head-on into a brick wall in front of the grandstand while chasing a foul fly. Double duty was rendered unconscious for several minutes, but begged to stay in the game when revived. A few innings later, double duty slumped over unconscious in the dugout and was rushed to the hospital. August 20th. With double duty catching, ex-Chicago Cub Ed Hanaszewski threw a no-hitter over Battle Creek, making double duty the only player in baseball history to pitch and catch 2 no-hitters. Hanaszewski struck out 14 and walked 2, and was supported by most of the lineup, including Radcliffe, who homered, doubled, and singled twice. August 23rd. Against the New York Black Yankees, Howard Easterling was intentionally walked with New York leading 4-3, bringing up old man Radcliffe. Duty laced the first pitch thrown to him for a 2-run double to win the game. August 24th. Babe Ruth may have done it in the 1932 World Series, but double duty definitely did it in a game against the Norfolk Royals of the Negro American Association. What he did was called a home run. The South Bend Tribune reported, quote, "The thrill came in the second when, after biting at a low pitch, the Norfolk bench began to razz Tad Radcliffe, Studebaker catcher. Radcliffe turned to the bench and said in an audible voice, 'If he puts one in around my neck, I'll put it out of the park.' This challenge was accepted by Norfolk pitcher Johnny Banks. The next pitch came in around Radcliffe's neck, and Ted smashed it over the left field wall." Unquote. Come September, the Studebakers made a surge and pulled into third place and entered the playoffs. Double duty caught the flu and missed the first series, but the Studebakers had little trouble beating Benton Harbor 2 straight in the best of 3. The Studebakers then met Lafayette in the best of 5 finals, with double duty still on the sick list. The Studebakers won the opener 11-9, and Lafayette came back winning Game 2 12-1 when they ran wild on the bases against backup catcher Julianix. Double duty returned for the 3rd game and stopped the Lafayette running by gunning down 3 runners, but Joe Desiderato had a big day at the plate, and Lafayette won 7-0. The Studebakers could only muster 5 hits in the game, Ray Scott and Dick Kosinski with 2, and double duty with 1. On September 20th, Lafayette became the Michigan-Indiana League champions. Double duty, still suffering from the flu, popped out as a pinch hitter in the 9th. If there was ever any doubt that double duty would have been a star in the major leagues, there wasn't any doubt after the 1948 season. In a league considered to be just a notch below the majors, 46-year-old double duty, 20 years past his prime, batted .312 and led his team in homers with 7 and RBIs with 34 in just 189 at-bats, a pace that would give him more than 20 homers and more than 100 RBIs in a full big league season. Radcliffe handled 297 chances behind the plate with only 5 errors, and in 3 appearances on the mound, his ERA was 2.73. More importantly, because Radcliffe, Lefty McInnes, and Howard Easterling played so well, South Bend continued to sign black ball players in the following years. Small but important steps.